O God of every nation, of every race and land, redeem the whole creation with your almighty hand. Where hate and fear divide us and bitter threats are hurled, in love and mercy guide us and heal our strife-torn world. From search for wealth and power and scorn of truth and right, from trust in bombs that shower destruction through the night, from pride of race and nation and blindness to your way, deliver every nation, eternal God, we pray. Lord, strengthen all who labor that we may find release from fear of rattling saber, from dread of war's increase. When hope and courage falter, your still small voice be heard. With faith that none can alter, your servants undergird. Keep bright in us the vision of days when war shall cease, when hatred and division give way to love and peace. Till dawns the morning glorious, when truth and justice reign, and Christ shall rule victorious o'er all the world's domain.
Welcome. Thank you for being here this morning. You'll notice that our service this morning is a different format than you're used to getting. It's set up as a lessons and carol service, which is what we use during Advent. It's also a participatory service, so I invite you to get your bulletin, say the responses, sing the songs, be part of communal worship. And now I invite us to pause for a moment, to recollect the dream that God has for us and for our nation, and to call ourselves into that dream. Blessed be God, who creates, redeems, and sanctifies, and blessed be the realm of God, now and forever. Hear the words of the Declaration of Independence, signed on July 4, 1776. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. As Christians who are Americans, we gather this day to thank God for the gifts of our freedom and liberty, to honor those whose vision, wisdom, and sacrifice secured these unalienable rights for us and for every generation, to confess that while we believe that all are created equal, we have not always allowed others to enjoy that freedom or those rights. We ask God's forgiveness and call upon God's unconditional love and boundless mercy to grant that we may be given the strength and courage to live more fully into our faith and beliefs. Let us pray. O Lord, our Governor, bless the leaders of our land, that we may be a people at peace among ourselves, and a blessing to other nations on the earth. Lord, keep this nation under your care. To the President and members of the Cabinet, to governors of states, mayors of cities, and to all in administrative authority, grant wisdom and grace in the exercise of their duties. Give grace to your servants, O Lord. To senators and representatives, and to those who make our laws in states, cities, and towns, give courage, wisdom, and foresight to provide for the needs of all our people and to fulfill our obligations in the community of nations. Give grace to your servants, O Lord. To judges and officers of our courts, give understanding and integrity, that human rights may be safeguarded and justice served. Give grace to your servants, O Lord. And finally, teach our people to rely on your strength and to accept their responsibilities to their fellow citizens, that they may elect trustworthy leaders and make wise decisions for the well-being of our society, that we may faithfully serve you in our generation and honor your holy name. For yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. Amen. And now let us remember our history, that our past may inform our future. Please be seated for the readings.
This is a reading from Abigail Adams to John Adams, March 31st, 1776. I long to hear that you have declared an independency, and by the way, in the new code of laws, which I suppose it will be necessary for you to make, I desire you would remember the ladies and be more generous and favorable to them than your ancestors. Do not put such unlimited power in the hands of the husbands. Remember, all men would be tyrants if they could. If particular care and attention is not paid to the ladies, we are determined to foment a rebellion and will not hold ourselves bound by any laws in which we have no voice or representation. That your sex are naturally tyrannical, it is a truth so thoroughly established as to admit of no dispute. But such of you as you wish to be happy willingly give up the harsh title of master for the more tender and endearing one of friend.
O day of God, draw nigh in beauty and in power. Come with thy timeless judgment now to match our present hour. Bring to our troubled minds, uncertain and afraid, the quiet of a steadfast faith, calm of a call obeyed. Bring justice to our land, that our midwest secure, and finally build for days to come foundations that endure. Bring to our world of strife thy sovereign word of peace, that war may haunt the earth no more and desolation cease. O day of God, draw nigh as at creation's birth. Let there be light again and set thy judgments in the earth.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord God Almighty, you have made all the peoples of the earth for your glory, to serve you in freedom and in peace. Give to the people of our country a zeal for justice and the strength of forbearance, that we may use our liberty in accordance with your gracious will, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from Chief Seattle's response to a government official's offer to purchase the remaining Seattle land, 1845. We will ponder your proposition, and when we decide, we will let you know. But should we accept it, I here and now make this condition, that we will not be denied the privilege, without molestation, of visiting at any time the tombs of our ancestors, friends, and children. Every part of this soil is sacred in the estimation of my people. Every hillside, every valley, every plain and grove has been hallowed by some sad or happy event in days long vanished. Even the rocks, which seem to be dumb and dead as they swelter in the sun along the silent shores, thrill with memories of stirring events connected with the lives of my people. And the very dust upon which you now stand responds more lovingly to their footsteps than yours, because it is rich with the blood of our ancestors, and our bare feet are conscious of the sympathetic touch. And when the last red man shall have perished, and the memory of my tribe shall have become a myth among the white men, these shores will swarm with the invisible dead of my tribe. And when your children's children think themselves alone in the field, the store, the shop, upon the highway, or in the silence of the pathless woods, they will not be alone. In all the earth, there is no place dedicated to solitude. The white man will never be alone. Let him be just and deal kindly with my people, for the dead are not powerless. Dead, did I say? There is no death, only a change of worlds. Here ends the reading.
What does the Lord require for praise and offering? What sacrifice, desire, or tribute did you bring? Do justly, love mercy, walk humbly with your God. Rulers of earth, give ear, should not just show. Will God your pleading hear, while crime and cruelty grow? Do justly, love mercy, walk humbly with your God. Still down the ages ring the prophet's stern commands. To merchant, worker, king, he bring God's high demands. Do justly, love mercy, walk humbly with your God. How shall my soul fulfill God's law so hard and high? Let Christ endue our will with grace to fortify. Then justly in mercy we'll humbly walk with God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O merciful Creator, your hand is open wide to satisfy the needs of every living creature. Make us always thankful for your loving providence, and grant that we, remembering the account that we must one day give, be faithful stewards of your good gifts. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who with you in the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from President John F. Kennedy's inaugural address, 1961. The world is very different now. For man holds in his mortal hands the power to abolish all forms of human poverty and all forms of human life. And yet, the same revolutionary beliefs for which our forebears fought are still at issue around the globe. The belief that the rights of man come not from the generosity of the state, but from the hand of God. We dare not forget today that we are the heirs of that first revolution. Let the word go forth from this time and place to friend and foe alike, that the torch has been passed to a new generation of Americans, born in this century, tempered by war, disciplined by a hard and bitter peace, proud of our ancient heritage, and unwilling to witness or permit the slow undoing of those human rights to which this nation has always been committed and to which we are committed today at home and around the world. So let us begin anew, remembering on both sides that civility is not a sign of weakness, and sincerity is always subject to proof. Let us never negotiate out of fear, but let us never fear to negotiate. Let both sides explore what problems unite us instead of belaboring those problems which divide us. Let both sides unite to heed in all corners of the earth the command of Isaiah to undo the heavily burdens and let the oppressed go free. And if a beachhead of cooperation may push back the jungle of suspicion, let both sides join in creating a new endeavor, not a new balance of power, but a new world of law where the strong are just and the weak secure and the peace preserved. In your hands, my fellow citizens, more than mine, will rest the final success or failure of our course. Now the trumpet summons us again. Not as a call to bear arms, though arms we need. Not as a call to battle, though embattled we are. But a call to bear the burden of a long twilight struggle, year in and year out, rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation. A struggle against the common enemies of man, tyranny, poverty, disease and war itself. Can we forge against these enemies a grand and global alliance, north and south, east and west, that can assure a more fruitful life for all mankind? Will you join in that historic effort? The energy, the faith, the devotion, when we bring to this endeavor, will light our country and all who serve it. And the glow from that fire can truly light the world. And so, my fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country. Here ends the reading.
Day of peace that dimly shines through our hopes and prayers and dreams, guide us to justice, truth, and love, delivered from our selfish schemes. May swords of hate fall from our hands, our hearts from envy find release, till by God's grace our warring world shall see Christ's promised reign of peace. Then shall the wolf dwell with the lamb, nor shall the fierce devour the small, as beasts and cattle will calmly graze, a little child shall lead them all. Then enemies shall learn to love, all creatures find their true accord, the hope of peace shall be fulfilled, for all the earth shall know the Lord.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, kindle, we pray, in every heart the true love of peace, and guide with your wisdom those who take counsel for the nations of the earth, that in tranquility your dominion may increase until the earth is filled with the knowledge of your love. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the letter from the Birmingham jail, Martin Luther King, Jr., 1963. Oppressed people cannot remain oppressed forever. The yearning for freedom eventually manifests itself, and that is what has happened to the American Negro. Something within has reminded him of his birthright of freedom, and something without has reminded him that it can be gained. The United States Negro is moving with a sense of great urgency toward the promised land of racial justice. If one recognizes this vital urge that has engulfed the Negro community, one should readily understand why public demonstrations are taking place. If his repressed emotions are not released in nonviolent ways, they will seek expression through violence. This is not a threat, but a fact of history. So I have not said to my people, get rid of your discontent. Rather, I have tried to say that this normal and healthy discontent can be channeled into the creative outlet of nonviolent direct action. And now, this approach has been termed extremist. But though I was initially disappointed at being categorized as an extremist, as I continued to think about the matter, I gradually gained a measure of satisfaction from the label. Was not Jesus an extremist for love? Love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. And was not Amos an extremist for justice? Let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. Was not Paul an extremist for the Christian gospel? I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus Christ. Was not Martin Luther an extremist? Here I stand. I cannot do otherwise. So help me God. And John Bunyan, I will stay in jail to the end of my days before I make a butchery of my conscience. And Abraham Lincoln, this nation cannot survive half slave and half free. And Thomas Jefferson, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. So the question is not whether we will be extremists, but what kind of extremists will we be? Will we be extremists for hate or for love? Will we be extremists for the preservation of injustice or for the extension of justice? In that dramatic scene on Calvary's Hill, three men were crucified. We must never forget that all three were crucified for the same crime, the crime of extremism. Two were extremists for immorality and thus fell below their environment. The other, Jesus Christ, was an extremist for love, truth, and goodness, and thereby rose above his environment. Perhaps the South, the nation, and the world are in dire need of creative extremists. Here ends the reading.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, who created us in your image, grant us grace fearlessly to contend against evil and to make no peace with oppression, and that we may reverently use our freedom, help us to employ it in the maintenance of justice in our communities and among the nations, to the glory of your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "You have heard that it was said, 'You shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy.' But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of each heart be always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Amen. Today, we continue the celebration of yesterday, the day on which America declared its freedom from the oppression of the English Empire. Our service gives voice to this celebration through our readings, prayers, and collects. 244 years ago, our founders wrote in the Declaration of Independence, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, and that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. These are the ideals to which they aspired." And I would dare say that as Americans, we continue to place a high premium on freedom. Over the course of our history, we have made sacrifices and fought wars for the cause of freedom. We sing songs and we rally around this cry for freedom. It's in our DNA, this desire for freedom that is so strong that we would risk our very lives for it. The founders believed that freedom was at the core of the being, that it was a right given by God. And we hear this plea for freedom in our readings and in our scripture today. The passage from the Gospel of Matthew is part of what we call the Sermon on the Mount. Great crowds are following Jesus, and they're eager, they're hungry to hear Jesus' words. So Jesus goes up the mountains, and his disciples follow him. Then he begins to talk to them. Now, in our modern context, we sometimes tend to gloss over these powerful words in the Gospel of Matthew. We hear them as nice and tranquil and some of that lovey-dovey stuff that Jesus says. But the disciples hear something different. They know Jesus and they trust him, so they're listening. They long for life just like we do today. They long for liberty, for freedom, just like we do today. They long for the ability to pursue happiness just like we do today, just like we have since the beginning of this country. White settlers came to this land to escape the English Empire, and our founders declared independence of this oppression and tyranny. But let's remember that this wasn't a beginning without its own transgressions. There were already people living in this land, people who didn't receive that same promise of freedom and hope from the very settlers who escaped the English persecution. Our readings today remind us that the struggle for freedom didn't end with the establishment of the United States, and it has never ended. In 1976, we heard Abigail Adams argue that the freedom of the ladies be included in the pursuits of the founders. And in 1845, Chief Seattle pleads for the kind and just treatment of his people after having witnessed the cruel genocide of the Native Americans that began with the settlers and still continues in many forms today. In 1961, President Kennedy called for a new world of law where the strong are just and the weak secure and the peace preserved. And on Good Friday in April 1963, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was arrested for leading peaceful protests in the city of Birmingham. This is a time referred to as the Birmingham Campaign, and he spent 8 days in jail. During the course of this campaign, several white religious leaders had written to criticize King and the timing of his campaign. These white leaders included two Methodist bishops, one Roman Catholic bishop, a Presbyterian pastor, a rabbi, and two Episcopal bishops. Now, while he's sitting in jail, Dr. King starts to respond to these leaders, and first he writes on the edges of any pieces of newspaper that he can find. And then someone sneaks scraps of paper to him so that he can write on those small scraps. And finally, his attorneys bring him pieces of paper that he can continue to write on. And Dr. King composes one of the most eloquent and powerful messages of the civil rights movement. It's referred to as the Letter from Birmingham Jail. And we only heard a small portion of it today. This is a 21-page letter. And in it, Dr. King quotes the same gospel reading from Matthew that we heard today. He calls Jesus an extremist for love. He asks, "The question is not whether we will be extremists, but what kind of extremist will we be? Will we be extremists for hate or for love?" And Jesus' response to the disciples in the ancient world is the same as it was in the 50s and 60s, and the same as it is now. It's love. It's always love. And it's not just love when it's easy or convenient or the people and things that we like and agree with. It's love, period. And that is a radical statement. It was a radical statement to the disciples who were hoping for someone to swoop in and save them from the Roman army. It was a radical statement in the 50s and 60s when Dr. King led the civil rights movement in his generation. And it's still a radical statement today. Love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. If you're a Democrat, pray for the Republican brothers and sisters. And if you're a Republican, pray for your Democratic brothers and sisters. If you're a conservative, pray for your liberal brothers and sisters. And if you're a liberal, pray for your conservative brothers and sisters. And this isn't just any old prayer. It's not just the prayer of, "I sure wish they'd see things my way," or "I hope they get what's coming to them." This is a radical prayer of love. The love of God, the one who tenderly and purposefully created each and every person on the face of this planet. This is a prayer of love for those we don't agree with those for whom we feel anger and, yes, even hatred. This is a radical prayer of love for those people on social media that we want to lash out against. And it's a radical prayer of love for those people on the news whom we think have lost their minds. Because the reverse is true, isn't it? I hope and pray that people are praying radical prayers of love for me, because I need them. and you need them, and we all need them. Earlier in his letter from Birmingham Jail, Dr. King writes, "Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny." And this is what Jesus knows. This mutuality is the radical part that Jesus was preaching to his followers then, and that he preaches to us today. God created each and every one of us in a web of relationship. We are inextricably tied to one another, and we need each other. We depend on each other for our very existence. Our Black and Brown and Native brothers and sisters need those of us who are white to speak up and to work to change these systems. That is our responsibility. And the truth is that those of us who are white need our Black brothers and sisters. We need our Black and Brown and Native brothers and sisters. We need them. We need them for our own healing. Our very salvation depends on them. Without them, we cannot be restored to wholeness. Because those of us who are white carry around an injury to our own souls that we often don't even recognize. To minimize the suffering and pain of our brothers and sisters is to do damage to our own humanity. It tears at the very fabric of who we are when we allow these injustices to continue. And Jesus is clear about this in every single gospel. The question is how and where, as Christians in the Episcopal branch of the Jesus movement, do we start? Emily Towns is the Dean of Divinity School at Vanderbilt University. She's a distinguished scholar and leader in theological education. She focuses on Christian ethics and womanist theology. And Dr. Townsend gives us wonderful direction as to how to move forward in this call from Jesus to love radically. She says, if we can hold on to proclaiming the truth when it gets buried in political and religious catfights and mud wrestling contests, I think we'll be able to bring together justice and peacekeeping. But only if we take seriously the challenges of living into what it means to believe that each person deserves to be treated with dignity and respect, because we are responsible for each other and for ourselves. We may get tired and need a break, but we must always come back, because we do not get out of this life alone, and we are responsible for what goes on in our names. She continues, ultimately, I believe that somewhere deep inside of each of us, we know that perhaps the simplest yet the most difficult answer to the challenge of what will we do with the fullness and incompleteness of what we have brought to this time and place is, live your life and faith with a deep love and respect for others and yourself. She says, I'm talking about what we call in Christian ethics the everydayness of moral acts. It's what Dr. Towns calls this everydayness that we live out Christ's radical prayer of love in the big and the small things. We live out this prayer when we listen closely to what people say and don't say, so that we can hear what they are truly trying to tell us. We live out this prayer when we take time each day to recenter ourselves on Christ's call to us. This prayer gives us strength and hope to not give in to despair and hopelessness. We live out this prayer when we are fully present with others as we walk together through this life. We live out this prayer when we keep pressing on in the midst of pain and suffering, whether others see it or not. We live out this prayer when we find precious moments of laughter and joy. We live out this prayer when we let down our defenses and open up our hearts and minds to the possibility of God's kingdom. And we live out this prayer when we admit that we have allowed God's people to be hurt, whether we were at fault or not. Dr. Towns concludes with this hope. It is in this everydayness that we, the people, are formed, and we, the people of faith, must live and must witness to a justice wrapped in a love that will not let us go, and a peace that is so ornery that it will never give up on us. In the name of our loving, liberating, and life-giving God, may we all live out a radical prayer of love that seeks freedom for each and every one of us. Amen.
I invite you to stand as you are able. And continuing on page 7 in our bulletins, let us say, we believe in God, who loves us and wants us to
love each other. This is our God. Believe in Jesus, who cared for children and held them in his arms. He wanted a world where everyone could live together in peace.
This is Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, who keeps working with us until everything is good and true. This is the Holy Spirit. We can be the church, which reminds people of God because we love each other. This we believe. Amen.
Let us pray together. Gracious God, we pray for your holy Catholic Church,
that we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you,
that your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons, especially Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, and Scott, our provisional bishop, that they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world, especially Donald, our president, Greg, our governor, and Betsy, our mayor, that there may be justice and peace on the earth. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake, that our works may find favor in your sight. Draw near those worshiping virtually today and all who are searching for a place to belong. Have compassion on those who suffer from any kind of grief or trouble, that they may be delivered from their distress. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. We praise you for your saints, who have entered into joy. May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom. Let us pray for our own needs and the needs of others.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in everlasting life. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, together we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever. Amen. Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Thanks be to God.